So I think today we are going to speak on Greenland transplantation, okay, right? So I'm just going to give you an overview and the basics of Greenland transplantation. What are the aspects involved in Greenland transplantation? It consists of two surgeries, okay? One is the donor surgery and one is the recipient surgery, and also evaluation of donor and recipient is done usually separately. So we are going to discuss kidney transplant in detail today, okay? So usually it is done for end stage renal disease, okay, that is permanent renal failure. It is defined as whenever the patients have, or the kidney has, a GFR of less than 10 ml per minute, or when the serum creatinine is more than 8 mg/cent, okay. The commonest etiology of end stage renal disease is diabetes, hypertension and glomerulonephritis, okay. So diabetes and hypertension is usually seen in elder patients, and glomerulonephritis is usually seen in younger patients. So the diagnosis is very easy. The ultrasound shows a very small shrunken both the kidneys. So whenever there are shrunken kidneys with raised creatinine, it is straight away labeled as end stage renal disease. Okay, no further investigation is required. Okay, and if the creatinine is raised and the kidney sizes are normal, then these patients are usually subjected for kidney biopsy, which will give the exact etiology of the condition. Okay, now once it is diagnosed, there are three types of treatments. One is hemodialysis, peritoneal dialysis, and the last permanent option of treatment of ESRD is to do a renal transplantation. Okay, so hemodialysis and peritoneal dialysis are temporary measures. Okay, so it will not give a complete cure to the patient of ESRD, and you have to do a kidney transplant to do to give a permanent cure. Okay, so transplant started way back in 1912. Carroll was given a Nobel Prize to where he showed how to do vascular suturing for vascular structures like vein, artery, and then slowly it developed over a period of time. And at the end, in 1984, a law was formed which is known as the Human Organ Transplant Act Law, which was formed in India to give an legal definition for organ transplantation. So we'll first see the evaluation of kidney transplant recipient, and then we will go for donor evaluation. Okay, now how do you select a kidney transplant recipient and how do you prepare the recipient? Okay, so now once the patient comes to you, you have to see whether there is any prior substance abuse, like analgesics. Excess use of analgesics can give rise to end stage renal disease. Then whether you have to see whether the patient is morbidly obese, whether there is any compliance problem. Why compliance is important? Because you are going to give immunosuppressant to these patients after kidney transplantation for the whole life. So the patient should be compliant. Patient should actually be ready to take the medicines for his whole life, because immunosuppressants are required to prevent any rejection of the kidney after kidney transplantation. Okay, then whether he is a high risk patient for cardiac diseases or high risk patient for surgery and anesthesia. Okay, so if these are all no, then he is a low risk patient. Okay, then you start evaluating for the kidney transplant surgery. If anything is yes, then drug screening, weight loss, contract with the patient that you take patient drugs regularly, evaluate for heart disease. If everything is okay, then you start evaluating for transplant. If there is any problem out of this condition, then it is the patient is not acceptable for transplant at present. Again, you correct the conditions and then you can advise the patient to do a kidney transplantation. Okay, now these are all the list of evaluation which are done for the recipients. Okay, problem list, like what are the morbid comorbid conditions, medications he's taking, a detailed medical history, immunization in past, examination of the patient, doing a chest x-ray, ECG, EKG, then ultrasonography, rule out infectious diseases, do a PSA in elderly male patient, that is prostate specific antigen to rule out malignancy, urine analysis is must in females more than 40, mammography should be done to rule out CA breast, eye examination, social service consultation for the cost of the surgery, dietary consultation, family education, financial counseling and HLA. So there are a lot of things, lot of investigations and lot of social and medical aspects you have to see in all the kidney transplantation. But why I have given you such a big list, because it is very important to evaluate, because the surgery is very major, and even if the surgery goes on well, there are multiple factors which can lead to rejection of the kidney, or which can have complications after doing a kidney transplant surgery. Okay, now after doing all the routine investigations, see whether there is any active infection, see whether there is any active malignancy, see whether there is any comorbid conditions, unsuitable conditions for technical successes of transplant, like multiple uncontrolled diabetes, atherosclerosis of the vessels, because we are going to use the vessels for a transplantation, and non-compliance of the patient. So once you see all this, okay, if there are no such factors, then accept the patient for KT. If there are some factors which are present, you have to correct them prior to kidney transplant. So it's very important that everything should be okay before you subject the patient for kidney transplantation. Okay. So apart from the blood investigations and urine evaluation of the patient, the most important thing is you have to rule out sepsis or focus of infection in the patient, like dental infection, infection at the dialysis access site, pulmonary infection, cholecystitis, cytomegalovirus. Why this is important, why infection is so important in kidney transplant patient, is because after transplant, you are going to start immunosuppression or immunosuppressive drugs, and that is going to take down the immunity of the patient. Once the immunity is going to go down, all these infections, if they are already present, they will flare up. So you have to control the infection first, and then you have to treat the, and then you have to subject the patient for surgery. Okay, if there is an active malignancy, then you have to wait for a period of 2 to 5 years so that a patient is completely cancer free, and then subject the patient for kidney transplantation. Okay, so there are certain unsuitable conditions for technical success, which I told you, and those are for the vascular system, because the vein and the artery of the recipient should be extremely good. Okay, because we are going to use the vein and artery for anastomosis, and after transplantation, the flow in the artery and the flow in the vein should be excellent. There should be no problem, because that is going to give you good perfusion of the kidney after a good surgery and good flow, and that is going to give us good urine output. Okay, so the arterial and the venous architecture in the recipient should be perfectly normal. There should be no problem like thrombosis. There should be no problem like claudication of the lower extremity, atherosclerosis of the vessels. So this all should be taken care of prior to transplantation. Okay. So once you do all this, then you have to urologically evaluate the patient. Suppose the patient has neurogenic bladder, then we have to do a micturating cystourethrogram, that is NCU, or you have to do a urodynamic study so that to see the bladder condition. Okay, if required, you have to do a cystoscopy to see the presence of lower urinary tract cancer or prostatic cancer, and do a RGP in few selected patients. So urological evaluation is important. Further evaluation of urological diseases, like to do a CT scan or bladder wash to rule out bladder CA bladder and bladder biopsies, also required. So basically, you have to rule out all the urological diseases in the donor, in the recipient, so that it will not hamper the post-operative course of the recipient surgery. Okay. So now, usually kidney transplantation is done in the right iliac fossa. The two kidneys of the recipient, which are non-functioning, which are small, are not removed. So after kidney transplantation, the patient will have three kidneys. Okay, two kidneys which are not functioning, which are not functioning and which are dormant, and there will be a third kidney which is placed in the right iliac fossa. Okay, but there are indications where you have to remove the kidneys in the recipient, like the kidneys which are non-functioning. What are the indications of removing the kidneys? That is the native kidneys of the recipient, renal stones, renal tumors, polycystic kidneys, persistent antiglomerular basement membrane antibodies in the recipient, significant proteinuria, pyelonephritis, and gross hydronephrosis. So these are the only conditions where we remove the non-functioning kidneys of the recipient. Otherwise, we don't remove the non-functioning kidneys of the recipient. We just do a transplant and place a new good functioning kidney in the right iliac fossa. Okay. Now coming to the donor evaluation. Now the once the recipient is evaluated, recipient is ready. Now you have to select a donor. Okay. Now donor can be either live related donor, it can be unrelated, or it can be a cadaver donor. Okay, so in detail we are going to speak about live related donor. Usually first degree relatives are accepted for donor nephrectomy or for a donor as a donor to the recipient. First degree relatives means mother, father, son, daughter, husband, wife. These are legally permitted to donate kidneys to their near ones, okay, or to their relatives. So once you select a donor, it should be the blood group should match. Okay, once the blood group matches, then only that donor is to be selected for that particular recipient. Matching of blood group is like ABO compatibility. Like B should can give to B, blood group A can donate to A. Blood group O is universal donor, so he can donate to A or B, and AB recipient is a universal recipient. So if the recipient has AB blood group, then either donor can be A blood group or B blood group. So this is ABO compatibility. That is very easy. You just do blood groups and select the donor. Now once the donor is selected, take a detailed history, medications, what he is on, whether he has blood pressure, whether he has diabetes, detailed physical examination. Okay, once all this is done, then see his mental status. Why mental status is important is because if the donor has mental disease, then it is a absolute contraindication for organ donation. Okay, because why they say this is the patient is mentally unstable. He is not able to decide whether he can, what are the consequences of kidney donation. Then the relatives can force him and ask him to donate his kidney. So if the patient should be absolutely mentally fit to decide that he is going to donate his kidney to his relatives. Okay, then presence of renal diseases, high risk mortality or morbidity to the donor, and whether he has any transmissible diseases. Okay, so once this is done, if this is no ABO compatible, donor is accepted for kidney transplantation. If anything is positive, that patient has got psychosis, there are renal diseases, diabetes, hypertension, disqualify, the donor cannot be accepted as a donor, or his kidney cannot be accepted to the recipient surgery. So these are the investigations. Once you do all the blood investigations, which are standard investigations, almost same what we do in recipient surgery. If they are all normal, then you do imaging of the kidneys, ureter, and bladder. That is, you do a CT, IVP, and a renal angiography to see the status of the vessels of the kidneys. Okay, a DTPA scan is done to know the functioning of the kidneys of both the donors. If everything is negative, posting for donor nephrectomy. If anything is positive, or the crossmatch is positive, or if there are abnormal veins, or if it is very difficult to anastomose, then disqualify the donor. So all the investigations, including radiological investigations, renal angiography, DTPA, should be done before you decide that the donor is fit. Why this is important? Both the kidneys of the donor should be normal. Okay, because you are going to remove one kidney of the donor, so the other kidney should be perfectly normally functioning kidneys, so that the donor should not have any problem after surgery, and he should be able to survive nicely with one kidney in the future. Okay, so evaluation of donor is very, very important. Right. So this is a picture of CT angiogram. So you can see the aorta, you can see the right renal artery. You can see the left renal artery nicely. This is a single artery. There's a branching of the artery. So during donor nephrectomy, you know where you are going to put your tie and where you are going to cut the renal artery, Okay, so this anatomy is very important. This is the kidney. So this is a CT angiogram, which shows all the renal architecture. This is a small capsular branch going to the capsule. You can sacrifice this. Okay, and these are the intra-renal vasculature or intrarenal branches. So usually we cut here and tie here so that we get a good length of artery, and vein is also cut at the same level. Now We'll just see what how the donor surgery is done. Usually, a 11th rib bed incision is taken. Kidney is completely mobilized. On the left side, gonadal, adrenal, and lumbar veins are ligated. Renal artery is mobilized till the aortic bulb. That is the origin of the renal artery from the aorta. On the right side, the renal vein is small because it immediately enters into the inferior vena cava. So, right donor nephrectomy, renal vein is taken with the IVC cuff. So, a part of IVC is taken on the right side, so that the length of the renal vein is more. If you only cut the renal vein, then it becomes a very short vein because it immediately inserts into the IVC. And the renal artery is also dissected till the aorta. Then ureter is dissected completely with lot of adventitia. Okay, and once good hydration is there, good urine output is there, the ureter is cut, vessels are tied, and the kidney is removed from the body. Once the kidney is removed, it goes to the recipient surgery. Now we'll just see how the recipient surgery is prepared. A central venous pressure monitor is placed, Foley's catheter is placed in the patient. Gibson incision is taken, cord is completely dissected. External iliac vein and internal iliac veins are dissected. Okay, so sorry, internal iliac artery dissected. So we are going to use the external iliac vein for venous anastomosis and internal iliac artery for arterial anastomosis. Okay, and arterial anastomosis can be either be done to end-to-end to the internal iliac artery or end-to-set to the external iliac artery. Now, if it is external iliac artery, you have to do an end-to-set because external iliac artery supplies the limb. So you cannot transect the external iliac artery. If you want to use external iliac artery, the renal artery will go to the side of external iliac artery. Venous anastomosis is done also end-to-set because the venous drainage should go to the IVC and to the heart. And then the ureter is re-implanted into the bladder. Usually it is an extravasical technique. Some people use stent, some people don't use a stent. So this is a picture in the right iliac fossa. This is the flank incision. Okay, this is the kidney. This is the renal vein, which is anastomose end-to-side through the external iliac vein. Okay, this is the renal artery, which is anastomose to the internal iliac artery end-to-end. This is the external iliac artery, internal iliac artery going to the renal artery, anastomosed to the renal artery. So this is how transplant is done. Okay. Now once the venous anastomosis is done, arterial anastomosis is done, then the clamps are released and you see a good flow of urine through the ureter. If once you see a good flow of urine through the ureter, that means your anastomosis is successful, your kidney has started working, then you anastomose this ureter to the bladder. Okay, that ends the surgery. Right, now coming to the complications of transplant. Okay, now the complications are usually because of HLA antigen, that is human histocompatibility complex antigen. These are class 1 and class 2 antigens. There are few types of rejection, like it can be hyperacute rejection, where immediately there is a rejection as soon as the kidney is placed, but it is very rare nowadays. Okay, then there can be acute rejection where the patient can present with flu-like symptoms, pain over the graft, hypertension, and decreased output, raised creatinine. Once this is all the symptoms are there, then patient has acute rejection and it is treated immediately by the nephrologist. Then the kidney can also get chronically rejected. That is after 3 years, 5 years, or 6 years down the line after transplant. Okay, and this is because of interstitial fibrosis or vascular changes in the transplanted kidney. Okay. Immunosuppression is given for all the patients. Without immunosuppression, the kidney will not work because it is a foreign body in the recipient. So you have to suppress the immunity so that that foreign body or that kidney will get accepted in the body. Okay. Now, there are certain problems after transplant. It can be early graft dysfunction, like graft, the kidney can stop functioning because of infection or rejection or urinary or vascular obstruction. Cyclosporine toxicity, which is usually given for immunosuppression, hyperglycemia, or dehydration. Okay, this has to be immediately treated. Then patient can also have infection. Usually signs of infection are there. Diagnosis is chest infection is very common, so you do X-ray chest first to rule out urine analysis. Urinary tract infection, do a urine analysis and then treat the patient immediately and treat the infection. Okay, if there is rejection, it is diagnosed by graft biopsy, which is very common. Without graft biopsy, you cannot diagnose rejection, and then it is treated by anti-rejection drugs. Okay, if there is urinary obstruction, then usually it is because the bladder clots. The diagnosis is immediately after surgery. There is no urine in the urine bag. So if it is bladder clots, you irrigate the bladder catheter, do ultrasound for diagnosis. If there is obstruction, you have to redo the anastomosis. Okay. Then calcineurin, that is immunosuppressant toxicity, is very, very common after transplantation because it is a nephrotoxic drug. So again, diagnosis is important, and you do blood levels of calcineurin inhibitor level. So immediately you come to know whether there is toxicity because of the calcineurin inhibitor drugs. Okay. Patient can also have hyperglycemia, dehydration, which is treated accordingly. Okay. Now there can also be vascular complication, that is surgical complication. There can be kinking of the kidney grafts, artery or vein. It is immediately recognized intraoperatively and repaired. There can be suture-less stenosis of the artery and the vein. So to immediately repair that if it is diagnosed. Okay. Then there can be vascular complication like venous complication, where the patient can have allograft rupture because of the venous obstruction. That is the renal vein. We have anastomosis, but there is obstruction. So there will be swelling of the kidney. So such kidneys have to be removed. That is, graft nephrectomy has to be done. Okay. Then allograft nephrectomy, I just now told you that. There are other problems of kidney transplant like hematuria, which can be early or which can be late. Early hematuria is because of the catheter trauma or ureteroneocysteostomy site. You have to treat it with irrigation, and endoscopy and clot evacuation is sometimes required, and surgical exploration is required to redo the anastomosis. Late hematuria can be because of medical renal disease, infection, calculus, or malignancy in the graft. There can be fluid collection. So you have to do an ultrasound, diagnose why the fluid collection is there, and treat accordingly. Okay. So the fluid collection post-transplant in the renal fossa can be pus, lymph, serum, or blood, urine or blood. Accordingly, it has to be treated. If there is ureteral obstruction, it can be early obstruction or late obstruction. Okay. These are the causes of early obstruction, is usually because of the technical error, edema at the ureteroneocysteostomy, blood clots, or calculus. So you have to treat accordingly. Late obstruction is because of fibrosis or calculi in the ureter. Diagnosis is done by DTP renal scan or nephrostogram, and you have to treat it accordingly. Either a repeat ureteroneocysteostomy or ureteropylostomy, ureteroureterostomy is usually required. Patient can also have urinary calculi after kidney transplantation, so it has to be treated endoscopically. Patient can also have urinary infection. So that is to be diagnosed by a urine culture and treated by antibiotics and antifungal agents. Patient can also have vesicoureteric reflux or erectile dysfunction because of the immunosuppression drugs which the patient is on. It has to be treated immediately. Just a small note on cadaver transplant. Okay, so cadaver donor is a brain dead cadaver or a brain dead patient, usually after vehicular accident or because of cerebral conditions. You have to select a cadaver who has normal renal function, no hypertension, no diabetes, no malignancy, no viral or bacterial infection. Okay. So once you select such a cadaver, then the kidney is selected and it is transplanted into the recipient. Okay. So this is an overview of transplant. Kidney transplant is a huge topic, but I just wanted to cover it, the complications. What exactly the transplant is, what is recipient surgery, what is donor surgery, how do you evaluate, and what are the complications which you have to treat. Okay, you don't have to see the know the details of all the treatment of complications, but the list of complications you should know. Okay.